Nudged presents What Manner of Murder? Bleakley Brothers Mystery 1 by Christopher William Hill. Narrated by Julian Wadham. Chapter 1. The Curse of Old Bramble Head. "The trouble with mysteries is this," said Horatio Bleakley, pulling the sucked remains of an aniseed ball from his mouth so he could make his point more clearly. "The harder you wish for something rippingly exciting to happen, the less likely it is that anything will happen at all. Umbrellas work in much the same way. There's always more chance of rain if you don't take your umbrella than if you do." It was late September, and the Bleakley brothers were travelling by motor car to the home of their aunt and uncle for the Michaelmas weekend. They were warmly wrapped up in long overcoats and scarves, and each wore his striped school cap. Outside, the sky was leaden, and a driving rain battered against the windows of the car. "It's all well and good you saying that," replied Eustace Bleakley patiently, "but if a fellow isn't paying proper attention to what's going on around him, then half a dozen mysteries could whiz past undetected. Let's not forget how I solved the mystery of Piggy Patterson's disappearing chocolate biscuits." "They were only disappearing because Piggy was eating them," snorted Horatio. "Yes, but in his sleep," protested Eustace. It took an ingenious bit of detective work to hit upon that solution. "Solution!" laughed Horatio, rolling his eyes. "Piggy woke up every morning surrounded by biscuit crumbs. Even the most pudding-headed nincompoop could have solved that puzzle." It was clear they were not destined to agree. So Eustace helped himself to an aniseed ball, sank back in his seat, and considered the best way to make a mystery happen, even if a mystery showed no sign of wanting to happen. Eustace was rather taller for his age than was quite usual, and this he attributed to superior intelligence and a reluctance to play sports. He had a long face and brown hair, entirely straight save for a cowlick at the fringe, which interrupted the uniformity of his face and which he was at constant pains to tame. Horatio, 3 minutes younger and 3 inches shorter than his brother, was a sturdy boy with untidy hair who prized sports above studies. Though the brothers were separated in age by no more than 180 seconds, Eustace was known at school as Bleakley Major, a title in which he revelled, and Horatio Bleakley Minor, a title which he loathed. It was tradition that the far-flung members of the family should descend on Bleakley Manor once a year at Michaelmas tide. And as Eustace had done well in his Latin exams, the boy's parents had arranged for a chauffeur in a gleaming black motor car to collect them from boarding school. As the car raced along the narrow country lanes, splashing through deep puddles, a thought occurred to Eustace, and he slipped an envelope from his blazer pocket. He removed a folded sheet of mauve writing paper, headed with the Bleakley family crest of 2 black crows above crossed swords. "Bleakley Manor, Ludonlie, Fenshire. Eustace and Horatio, your father has sent a telegram to inform me that you will be arriving on the 28th of September by motor car from your school. Why he has run to the expense of hiring such a vehicle, I really cannot say, but I imagine there must be a reason for it. Whatever reason that might be is of no consequence, but I would be grateful if you would stop at the railway station at Brockton Manorley at 3 o'clock to collect Master Oliver Davenport, who will also be staying with us for the Michaelmas weekend. Master Davenport is a poor unfortunate, and we must take pity on the boy, no matter how inconvenient that may be. Please be certain not to bring any unnecessary dirt to the house. Aunt Maud." "Is Master Oliver Davenport an orphan, do do you think? Asked Horatio, as Eustace refolded the letter and returned it to his pocket.
I'm rather afraid he is, said Eustace. Aunt Maud generally means orphan when she writes poor unfortunate with capital letters.
Leaning forward, he wound down the connecting window to speak to the chauffeur.
Don't forget we're collecting Master Oliver Davenport from the railway station. It isn't very far out of our way.
Very good, sir, said the chauffeur.
The down train had just departed from Brockton Manorley as the car arrived, and a billowing cloud of white steam hung heavy above the station buildings. A small boy, with a shock of curly red hair, was waiting patiently outside in the rain, surrounded by an assortment of bags and battered suitcases. Eustace and Horatio climbed out of the motor car to greet the new arrival. Eustace walked ahead, as seemed right and proper for a boy 3 minutes his brother's senior.
You must be Master Oliver Davenport, he called, opening out an umbrella. I'm Bleakley Major, and this is my brother Bleakley Minor.
We're not at school now, tutted Horatio. We only need our first names. He smiled at the newcomer.
I'm Horatio, and this blighter is my brother Eustace.
Hello. Very pleased to meet you, said Master Oliver Davenport, all the time jabbing vigorously at his right eye with the corner of a grubby pocket handkerchief. I would shake hands, you know, only I got a smut in my eye, and it's absolute agony.
Were you leaning out of the compartment window? Asked Horatio.
I was, said the boy.
You would have had your head sliced off if there'd been a train coming in the other direction, said Horatio cheerfully. Heaps of boys have had their heads hacked off by passing steam trains. They're always warning us of it at school.
At least my eye wouldn't be hurting if my head had come off, said Master Oliver Davenport philosophically, prodding his eye again with the grimy handkerchief.
There. I think that shifted it.
The rain was falling heavily now, and the chauffeur took care of Master Oliver Davenport's luggage as the boys climbed gratefully into the warm motor car, slamming the door shut behind them.
"Have you had to travel very far from your school?" asked Eustace,
as the engine hummed once more and the car pulled slowly away from the station.
2 hours and 3 trains," replied Master Oliver Davenport.
The more distance there is between me and those tormentors of souls who pass themselves off as teachers, the better. He grinned at the two boys.
It seems your family has taken pity on me. Are they frightfully rich, your aunt and uncle?
Eustace considered it poor form to discuss the wealth of his relatives, but as Master Oliver Davenport was shortly to arrive at Bleakley Manor, and the enormous wealth of the family would become manifestly obvious, he broke his golden rule.
Absolutely rolling in cash, he said. Oodles of the stuff. Uncle Max is chairman of Bleakley Bottling Inc. They make pickles, you know.
Cripes, said Master Oliver Davenport, his eyes wide with surprise.
We must have their mustard piccalilli in our sandwiches at school, but very thinly spread, more's the pity.
It's the mustard piccalilli that made the Bleakley fortune, said Eustace. The family hardly had a penny in the bank before Uncle Max took up pickling. Bleakley Manor was practically falling down around his ears. Master Oliver Davenport smiled.
Just the sort of rich old cove who gets bumped off in a ripping murder mystery. You know, with some treacherous relative hoping to get their hands on the loot. He proffered a paper bag. Peanut brittle.
Eustace and Horatio each took a nugget of the peanut brittle and settled back in their seats, gazing out of the windows as the flat, waterlogged landscape flashed past.
"Did your aunt describe me as a poor unfortunate?" asked Master Oliver Davenport. "That's how I'm generally introduced into conversations."
Though Master Oliver Davenport had been described in precisely those terms, Eustace and Horatio
were polite enough not to admit it. "I'm an orphan, you see," added the boy, by way of explanation, sucking so hard on a shard of the peanut brittle that his tongue throbbed.
"Yes, dashed hard luck," murmured Horatio.
"Oh, it's not so bad, really," continued Master Oliver Davenport. "My parents were frightfully well connected before they kicked the bucket, and now all sorts of people take pity on me and invite me to stay. It gives them a tremendous thrill having a needy orphan about the place. Good Samaritans and all that." He turned hopefully to his fellow passengers.
"I don't suppose you're orphans as well, are you? Is that why you're staying with your aunt and uncle?"
Eustace shook his head. "No, our parents are still very much alive," he replied apologetically. "They live in India."
"Of course they could be dead by now," said Horatio,
not wishing to appear boastful about the fortunate survival of their own mother and father.
"Lots of tigers and snakes and things. And it takes such a long time to wire through a telegram. They might have been dead for weeks and weeks, and we'd both be none the wiser."
"It's kind of you to say so," said Master Oliver Davenport. "But if they haven't been eaten by tigers, what is it that they do in India?"
"Father's a diplomat," said Eustace.
"And mother is something to do with cocktail parties," added Horatio, as the car roared on toward Ludon Lye. "I forget what."
"When we're not at boarding school, we have our halls with Aunt Amelia and Cousin Loveday," said Eustace. "And every year at Michaelmas, the family gathers at Bleakley Manor."
"Whether we like it or not," said Horatio, with a wink to his brother. "We never have worked out if it's a treat or a punishment."
A thought seemed to dawn on Master Oliver Davenport.
"I hope you won't think me too inquisitive for asking," he said, pulling out a rolled-up copy of the Archaeological Gazette from his blazer pocket. "But is this Bleakley a relative of yours?"
He leafed quickly through the pages of the magazine and pointed to a photograph of an explorer in long shorts and a pith helmet. The man was standing at the entrance to an unearthed tomb, leaning against a large terracotta bust engraved with ancient Egyptian hieroglyphs.
Horatio laughed. "He's one of our uncles," he said. "Colonel Theodore Bleakley, always digging things up halfway across the world. A priceless chap, but nutty as a fruitcake. He'd be just as happy with an old cracked pot as he would with a treasure chest full of gold."
"He's a bit of a hero of mine, actually," confessed Master Oliver Davenport. "I read all about his exploits in Egypt. He was trying to uncover the treasure of An-Ak."
"And what treasure was that?" asked Eustace, who had lost track of his uncle's failed searches for lost riches.
"A solid gold statue of Osiris, the Egyptian god of the afterlife," replied Master Oliver Davenport.
He tapped the pages of the magazine.
"It was thought to have been hidden inside a terracotta bust, but it was never found. It's worth a king's ransom. You should read the article. It's a corking story, even if the colonel did come back empty-handed."
"When he's not exploring, he lives at Bleakley Manor," said Eustace. "He'll be there for Michaelmas. You can count on that."
"I was awfully bucked to be coming back with you for the weekend anyway," gushed Master Oliver Davenport. "But if Colonel Theodore Bleakley is going to be there as well, cripes, that's the icing on the cake."
The motor car turned a sharp corner that brought them into the village of Ludon Lye. It was a bleak place of grey stone and ancient wooden beams. A fast-running stream, fed by the downpour, gurgled along by the side of the road. As the car passed a small parade of shops, Eustace opened the connecting window once more to speak to the chauffeur.
There's a newsagent's on the left-hand side up ahead," said the boy, who wished to buy pencils and a new pocket notebook in the fervent hope that a mystery might occur, no matter what Horatio said to the contrary.
Would you stop there, please?"
"Yes, sir, very good, sir," said the chauffeur, applying the brakes and pulling up alongside the shop.
As Eustace stocked up on stationery, Horatio and Master Oliver Davenport chose sweets from the long row of glass jars behind the shop counter. The boys made their selection with infinite care, deciding between peppermint bullseyes and pineapple cubes, licorice toffees and buttered Brazils.
"We'll have a quarter of the licorice toffees, please," said Master Oliver Davenport at last.
The young woman serving took down the jar and emptied the sweets onto the scales.
"Just over the quarter," she said.
Master Oliver Davenport smiled greedily.
"I'd rather have it over than under."
"You're Sir Max and Lady Maud's nephews, aren't you?" said the woman, scooping the toffees into a paper bag.
"That's right," replied Horatio. "And this is a new friend of ours, Master Oliver Davenport. We're staying at Bleakley Manor for the Michaelmas weekend."
A hacking cough and a cloud of tobacco smoke announced the arrival of a hunched and elderly man from the back of the shop.
"What's that you say?"
he asked, sucking on an old briar pipe.
"Bleakley Manor, is it? Careful old Bramblehead don't come and get you, that's what I says."
"What do you mean?" asked Master Oliver Davenport, shooting an anxious glance at Horatio. "Who's old Bramblehead?"
"We know the legend all right, sir," laughed Horatio, "but I think we'll be safe enough at the manor for another year."
The old man fixed the boys with piercing grey eyes and sucked again on his pipe.
"That's what you think, is it?" he rasped, leaning against the counter and breathing out a thick fog of smoke. "Well, let me tell you this much, my lad."
"Enough of your nonsense, Grandpa," chided the young woman. "You're scaring the boys."
She turned to Eustace and smiled nervously.
"I've got more notebooks out the back," she said. "I'll go and fetch them for you."
As the woman hurried away, the old man leaned across the shop counter, lowering his voice so he could not be overheard by his granddaughter.
"There's dark things at Bleakley Manor," he said. "Things that certain folk don't want me a-telling of to the likes of you."
"The likes of us?" repeated Eustace.
"Whatever do you mean?" "Young'uns, I means," explained the old man. "Impressionable minds that'll get the horrors if I tells them all the dark tales I know of."
"Well, it's all just superstition," cried Horatio. "There's not a word of truth in it."
But the old man shook his head.
"Old Bramblehead will rise up come midnight or Michaelmas Eve, you mark my words," he hissed, with shoulders wreathed in brambles and his wicked grin stained dark with blackberries.
Master Oliver Davenport shivered, as though an icy hand had passed slowly along his spine.
"But that's tonight," he whispered hoarsely.
There was no stopping the old man now his tale was begun.
"Arms like pitchforks he's got," he continued, slowly raising his hands and extending his long, bony fingers. "His bramble claws scratch, scratch at the window panes, and his face." He shook his head and moaned in horror. "Such a terrible face. It's not skin, as you might think, but more alike to sackcloth than human flesh. His breath is of the marsh. There's no hair to speak of. Instead, the creature's all over brambles. And when he catches his victims, he drags them down to their deaths in the marsh water, never to be seen again."
"Grandpa," snapped the woman, returning from the back room with the notebooks. "That's enough."
The old man scowled at his granddaughter and turned away from the boys. Reaching up to a shelf for a tin of condensed milk, he shuffled out the way he had come, lost in another choking cloud of tobacco smoke. Eustace selected a pocket notebook with a red cover. The boys paid for their supplies and made their way to the door.
"And a happy Michaelmas to you all," said the young woman, though her voice seemed to tremble a bit as she spoke, and the words struck hollow.
The boys stepped outside onto the pavement, and the shop bell jangled noisily behind them.
"Ha! How peculiar!" said Master Oliver Davenport, with a nervous laugh. "I half believed the old man when he started talking about Old Bramble Head."
"It's not all that peculiar," said Horatio, helping himself to a licorice toffee. "Not in these parts. At any rate,
Ludd-on-Lye is a strange place."
"They are rather prone to superstition," agreed Eustace, as they crossed the pavement and climbed back into the waiting motor car.
"It's an old myth that Bleakley Manor is haunted by a creature from the marshes. They say it was a servant who was turned mad by the marsh vapours several centuries ago and came back transformed into a monster to wreak his revenge on the Bleakley family. But it's all stuff and nonsense, of course."
The car roared past the Stoat and Raven pub before passing the old stone pillar that marked the boundary between the village and the outer fringes of the Bleakley estate.
"That's the manor house in the distance," said Eustace, sitting up in his seat and pointing ahead. "You can just about see the chimney pots through the trees."
The house was reached by way of an ancient road bridge, on wooden struts across a wide expanse of green marshland. The chauffeur slowed the motor car to a crawl and drove cautiously over the creaking bridge. Horatio wound down his window and leaned out, so that he had an uninterrupted view across the marshes.
"What would happen if the bridge were to fall down?" asked Master Oliver Davenport, hardly daring to glance out as the car rolled slowly over the rickety planks.
"Then Bleakley Manor would be cut off from Ludd-on-Lye," said Horatio. "It's an island, really. When it's as wet as this, there's no way of crossing the marsh without being sucked down to your certain doom."
Master Oliver Davenport shuddered and screwed his eyes shut.
At the end of the bridge, a gravel path snaked through a dark tunnel of horse chestnut trees on its approach to the house. As the car rounded a corner, the wind picked up, and the boys were greeted by an ominous howl of foreboding. High above them, standing out in sharp relief against the slate-grey sky, loomed the towering walls of Bleakley Manor.
Chapter 2. A Stranger at the Door.
The motor car came to a crunching halt on the gravel, and the chauffeur climbed out to help the three boys with their luggage. Though the rain had eased, the sky was dark and brooding. A howling wind rocked the horse-chestnut trees, and crows chattered uneasily from the branches.
"So this where you're staying for your Michaelmas weekend, is it?" asked the man.
"That's right," said Eustace. "Bleakley Manor, the family pile."
"Gives me the shivers just looking at it," said the chauffeur, glancing up at the house.
It was a strange, lofty building of red brick, with tall and slender chimneys, the shape of barley sugar twists.
"Like something out of the horror flicks."
As the boys took their bags and cases from the boot of the motor car, a taxicab drew up behind them.
"Look," said Horatio, as a girl inside the cab waved violently at the boys. "It's Cousin Loveday."
"Hello, cuz,"
said Eustace, as the taxi stopped and Loveday jumped out, slamming the door so hard behind her that the boys were quite certain it would snap off at the hinges.
"I wanted him to race you," said Loveday with a grin, "but he wouldn't. Not an ounce of sporting spirit in him."
She was a thin and gangly girl with a rash of freckles and hair tied up in messy pigtails. In one hand she clutched a suitcase, and in the other a badly battered lacrosse stick.
"I thought Aunt Amelia was coming with you," said Horatio.
"Oh, you know what Mav's like," huffed Loveday. "She had another of her swooning fits, and she packed me off on my own. If you ask me, she's using it as an excuse to wiggle out of the festivities, and who can blame the old pet? Now my back's turned, she's most likely stretched out in front of the gramophone scoffing chocolates by the boxful. So, who's the new inmate?"
She smiled at the newcomer
and gave the boy a jovial prod on the shoulder with the tip of her lacrosse stick. "Staying for Michaelmas, are you?"
"This is Master Oliver Davenport," said Horatio. "He's an orphan."
"Pleased to meet you," said Loveday. "Actually, my father snuffed it before I was born, so I suppose I'm a half-orphan."
"That doesn't really count," said Master Oliver Davenport, "but you're very kind to make the effort."
The motor car and the taxicab roared off along the drive, disappearing behind the tall trees, and the four children were left alone.
"Ah, at last," said Loveday, with a deep sigh of relief. "Free from Miss Sunnybrook's school for a whole weekend."
Master Oliver Davenport stood gazing up at the lofty brick walls of Bleakley Manor.
"It's not a nice house," said Eustace, as if reading the boy's mind, "but it's a solid house. It's not likely to crumble to dust while we're asleep in our beds."
"It looks like the sort of place where bad things have happened," whispered Master Oliver Davenport.
Loveday and her cousins knew well the grim history of the great house. It had begun its existence modestly enough, but had swollen over the centuries, becoming progressively uglier with each passing generation of the Bleakley family. It had grown up, and it had grown out. A turret had been added here, a parapet there. The entire edifice was wrapped round with ivy, as if held together by an enormous green sticking plaster.
"Oh, heaps and heaps of bad things," said Loveday, tearing at the ivy with her lacrosse stick and sending a cluster of spiders scuttling for cover.
"Well, here we are," said Eustace, as they climbed the stone steps to the house. Master Oliver Davenport peered up at the vast door of studded oak that was the port of entry to Bleakley Manor, flinching as a crow cackled at him from the parapet. Above the door was a stone carving of the family crest. He attempted to make out the wording, which had been worn and pitted by centuries of inclement weather.
Morscum Laetitia, finished Eustace. "It's the family motto. It means death with joyfulness."
"Not the jolliest of mottos, I suppose," said Loveday. "But then the Bleakleys aren't the jolliest of families."
Eustace reached up and pulled at a heavy iron handle beside the door.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.